Today, you're privileged to hear and to have one of our alums, Dr. Wayne Isom. He grew up in Idaloo, Texas, and somebody forgot to pull him over the side and said, you can't do all that. He's noted by some as the best heart surgeon in the world. He did David Letterman's, he did Walter Cronkite's, he did Larry King's. He's tops. He graduated in medical school from Southwestern. He is head of the cardiothoracic surgery at the New York Presbyterian Hospital and the Weill Cornell Medical Center. He's also a professor. He's gotten many awards, but he has never forgotten where he came from. And he's always been a proud Red Raider, no matter what he was doing or where he was. You're privileged today to hear my good friend, Dr. Wayne Isom.
Well, I appreciate everything that's been said. I think I could just sit down now and say I agree with John Steinmetz and Chancellor Hance, and would be fine because I agree with everything they've said. I got to admit to you, though, that I did not graduate from Texas Tech. I dropped out of 3 years, so I'm a college dropout. Supposedly tomorrow they're going to give me a degree. Kent said it, but I'll believe it when I see it. But at any rate, more seriously, I really appreciate being invited back to Texas Tech. It's been part of my life. Kent said that it's 1961 when he started to college. I can remember Texas Tech from the time I was 5 years old. We would come over from Idaloo, see the football games and the basketball games, drive by the Will Rogers Memorial, and it was part of my life. I knew every football player, every basketball player from that time on. And so there's never any question about where I should go to school. I mean, Texas Tech was the only one. Somebody who was nuts might go to Texas A&M or the University of Texas, but why would anybody want to go anywhere except Texas Tech? He's right. I grew up in a cotton farm about 12 miles east of here, about 1.5 miles north of Idaloo on the Amarillo Highway. And when I was a little boy growing up, and a lot of people will ask me now, you know, with your background, going to Idaloo, I didn't have any chemistry or biology. My science was vocational agriculture, and that's all I had. And I was 4-H and FFA and right down to the end. And a lot of people said, well, was there an epiphany or something that happened in your life that made you want to go into medicine or surgery? And I've sort of got a confession to make to you. Like all kids at that age in high school, you think about, I thought about being an astronaut, a pilot, all sorts of things, and even medicine in there. But I really thought I would probably be a farmer back in Idaho. I loved the outside. It was always great. I like to see livestock. I like to see things grow. My dad used to say on a hot summer day in July, when with enough moisture, you had to have enough rain, but with enough moisture, you could hear the cotton or the corn grow. I'm not sure I could hear it, but you could almost see it grow. In a pasture of 100 cows and calves, within 3 minutes, he could look at it and know that one cow was missing or one calf was missing. So I grew up with that idea, and that's probably what I would have done. But a confession I got to make to you today, there was a moment of epiphany. I used to work and drive a tractor out there cultivating cotton or whatever, corn. And my dad was a real conservationist back before conservation was even a term. And he had a rule that if you were cultivating cotton, if you got sleepy or you were getting off the row, you had to stop the tractor, walk around the tractor a little bit till you could wake up and get back on. Now, I just read an article about the so-called power nap, that in the morning or evening, you could take a 15-minute power nap. Maybe some of you still do it. In some of the classes, I can ask some of the professors, but you could take a power nap, and then you'd be more efficient the rest of the day. Well, about, my dad would get me started on the tractor about somewhere between 6:30 and 7 o'clock in the morning, and he would come back and pick me up about noon. And about 10 o'clock, I'd get sleepy, and so I decided, reading that article about the power nap, I decided one morning, well, I'll stop the tractor, like he said, and I got under the tractor, in the shade of the tractor, and took a power nap, and it worked. It was really good, and I'd go and plow till noon. Sometimes it might be a little longer than 15 minutes, depending on how late I'd stayed out the night before, but I would do that. Finally, and this is the epiphany, my dad doubled back one morning and came back about 10 o'clock and found me sleeping on the tractor. And I woke up with his gentle kick, and he said, "By God, boy, you better be a doctor. You're too damn lazy to be a farmer." So, so I didn't have any other choice but going to medicine. Seriously, just a few words. You're the 2013 graduates. You're part of the so-called Generation Y, or the Millennium Generation. You are the most educated generation in American history. But since 2008, with the recession, you're going to be most challenged in finding a job. That's just being realistic. Don't get too depressed. I'm going to share with you briefly what has really helped me over the ensuing years. And I've got it narrowed down to two things. One is the 5 A's. And if you don't remember anything else today, remember this. It's pretty easy to remember. The first A is availability. I'm going to use some medical examples, but it applies in anything you do. Availability. If you're not available, say as a doctor, if you're not available as an architect or an entertainer, no matter what you do, you're not going to be successful. You've got to be available. I'm sure you've all experienced, one of the things that really bothers me is I call up a doctor's office and I get this answering machine. It says, dial 911 if it's an emergency. Everybody knows to do that. And then they say, if it's Blue Cross Blue Shield, question, press 2. If it's United, press 3. And finally, they get somewhere, if it's to make an appointment, leave us your number and we'll call you back. Well, you know, if you're not available, you can't be a success. In our offices, we have no answering machine. I guarantee you, if you call my office, you're going to get a human being who answers the phone, and hopefully they're nice to you. In fact, I check it periodically. I have my wife call and check to see how quick they answer the phone. Which brings me to the next day. So first one's availability. Next day is affability. You got to be able to get along with people, no matter how good you are. You look at entertainers. You look at athletes. You look at doctors. You look at anybody. You've got to be able to get along with people. Everybody's got a boss. And it's just as easy to be nice. In fact, there's been data, physiological data, that shows it's a lot easier to be nice than it is to be hateful or you know, you go to a doctor's office and the nurse says, sit down over there, or fill this out, or you can't do this, or you can't do that. You know, no matter what kind of results you get, if they're sort of hateful, you really can't be a success. So whatever you do, you've got to be affable. You've got to be able to get along. Not obsequious, not a yes person, but you need to be able to get along with people. And I could give you some examples that I don't have time to right now. The third A is ability. That's the reason you came to Tech, to learn what you need to know in your profession. And the diploma you're going to get is just a license to learn. You've got to keep after that. The ability, you've got to be good, you've got to be the best in your field. And it's a challenge, but and I can use this as an example. I can have the first two, availability, affability. But if the patients come to me and they die or they have a big complication, the first two doesn't matter. If you're an architect, if you build the greatest building around and you're nice and everybody says you're great, but that building falls down in 3 years, the first two don't matter. The fourth one is accountability. In this day of information technology, you've got to be able to analyze data. You've got to know it, and you've got to be able to look at it objectively. And that's some of the things that we didn't have in the past, but the last 15 or 20 years, you've got to know what your results are, and you've got to be able to objectively look at it. And you can get that very easily now with information technology. The last one is affordability. One of the reasons medicine's in the shape it's in today with all the problems is it's not just doctors, but hospitals, drugs, mechanical equipment. We've priced ourselves completely out of the market. It's not affordable anymore. And that's a problem. No matter how good a football player you are, if you got a scholarship here and you're going to play for one of the pro teams, if you're asking too much to play, you're not going to play. The same way when you go out for a job, there may be a job that you really want, and you think, well, I'm more qualified. Don't price yourself out of it. I've seen situations where people say, and you've all heard this, I worked for the first year for, you know, a small salary. Just give me a chance. So those are things. Remember, availability, affability, ability, accountability, and affordability. That has helped me more than anything else in trying to be successful. I said there's two things. The second thing is one of the things you're going to get today, and that's a diploma from Texas Tech. And that diploma signifies that you've accomplished a certain stage. Again, as I said, it's sort of a diploma to learn. You're going to continue learning. If you don't stay up, in fact, I'll guarantee, I tell the medical students at Cornell when I give them the lectures, don't believe everything I tell you. At least 40 to 50% of it's probably wrong. So they're going to have to learn and keep learning and find out what's right. The same way with your professors here. The part of the diploma and the part of being a graduate of Texas Tech is what I referred to many times is the spirit of Texas Tech. And what I mean by spirit is, it's almost the spirit of West Texas. It's probably spawned by the fact that this was a hostile environment when the settlers came here. It's a little hostile in the 20s when Tech was organized and built here. It's an environment in which it's either too hot or too cold or too wet or too dry. You've experienced that if you've been here 4 years. It was too cold 5 days ago, and it's going to be too hot this afternoon. So you've experienced that. It's a philosophy or the environment in which if you've got a problem, you either live with it or you fix it, because nobody's coming to fix it for you. It's an independence of spirit. The other thing is the philosophy of you can do whatever you want to do if you work at it hard enough and long enough. We've all seen, and I've seen it over the years, some team is number one in the nation, and Texas Tech is not even ranked, and the next weekend Texas Tech just beats the socks off of them. It didn't happen this year. I was hoping it would, but it didn't. So just remember those things, the five A's, remember Texas Tech, the spirit of Texas Tech, and keep that in mind as you go forth. And there's no doubt in my mind you'll be successful. Thank you.